Good day once again. We, honourable members, are going to start. We're not going to repeat method of work every time we start. We will just get down to business. First of all, to Ms. Mokhobo, welcome, and thanks for making yourself available. Honourable members, so that this question is not asked, members will recall that at some point during the preparations, there were certain potential witnesses who had concerns in camera and that type of thing. And the witness before us was one of those that had that type of concern. So thus, and by the time we had resolved and all come to some sort of agreement, it left very little time to prepare a statement. So you don't have a statement before you in this case. We will rely on the transcripts at the end of the day. So what I'm saying is that you therefore need to take copious notes. You wouldn't be able to refer to any document. I hope you bear with us in that regard, and it explains why, as opposed to the first one, you do not have a statement. Mokhobo is the name, isn't it? Mokhobo. I beg your pardon. Ms. Mokhobo, please be informed that by law you are required to answer fully and satisfactorily all the questions lawfully put to you, or to produce any documents that you are required to produce in connection with the subject matter of the inquiry. Notwithstanding the fact that the answer or the document could incriminate you or expose you to criminal or civil proceedings or damages, you are, however, protected in that evidence given under oath or affirmation before a House or a committee may not be used against you in any court or place outside Parliament, except in criminal proceedings concerning a charge of perjury or a charge relating to the evidence or documents required in these proceedings. And we have given you a copy of what I've just read, ma'am. You have also indicated that you will take the oath. If you could repeat after me. I swear by Almighty God.
I swear by the Almighty God.
That the evidence I shall give,
that the evidence I shall give,
will be the truth,
will be the truth,
the whole truth,
the whole truth,
and nothing but the truth,
and nothing but the truth.
Please say, so help me God. Raise your hand and say,
so help me God.
And bring it to the table. It is 8 minutes past 12. You have got until 1 o'clock. You've got an hour to do your business at the most, and then we'll open up. Thank you, sir.
Ms. Mokhobo, can you, for the record, please state your full names?
Lulama Patricia Mokhobo.
What was your position at the SABC?
I was Group CEO.
Can you give us the period that you were meant to serve? And can you tell us for how long did you last with the corporation?
I was appointed on the 16th of January 2012, and I should have completed my tenure around the same period, 2017.
you were the link between the board, the executive authority, or the accounting authority, and the administration of the corporation, correct?
It's a bit of a tricky question. In terms of company law, that's what I was supposed to be. However, the boards under which I served had a very significant leaning towards Mr. Mutsuni, with the result that my ability to be that which you have articulated now was severely tempered with. So I ceased to be a normal link in the sense that I think you're contemplating.
In what way was your role compromised?
There were many, many instances, and what I'm about to say is covered in my response to the public protector when she sent me the draft report to go through. There were many, many instances where Mr. Mutsuning had meetings with the board chair and other board members. And those meetings would be conducted without my knowledge or presence. And to that degree, many times, there would be things that were planned which I would not be aware of. And frequently, I would be made to appear as somebody who didn't know what they were doing. However, I was generally quite juniorized. And to quite a degree, it seemed Mr. Mutsuning was, to use slang, the go-to man. My role was largely confined, and I think it's a choice that I made to ensuring that the company came back to financial sustainability. I had been given a very strict mandate by the Dr. Ngubane board, under whom I served, to make sure that the government guarantee requirements were implemented, that austerity measures were implemented. And there was quite a list of requirements that had to be met. There were some that were impossible to meet purely because they required to be met over a period of time and could not be done as quickly as they should have. But there were those that were not too difficult to meet. The key one being putting financial controls back in place and ensuring that the financial bleeding that was happening in the company was stemmed dramatically. And I did that with the support, I must add, of the board, who saw the importance of that work being done. And to that extent, we were able to report a profit at the end of my first year there, the end of 2013, and again at the end of my second year, which was February 2014. And the profit was substantial, and it all had to do with very, very prudent financial management, where part of the fractious relationship arose because I simply refused to sign off on certain contracts that didn't make sense to me.
Before we get to some of the challenges, just want us to be structured in how we do your presentation. As a group chief executive, you're driving strategy. And this strategy you derive from your board.
Yes.
Other than the issue of the guarantee, you say you were given marching orders by your board of Dr. Ngubane. What were the other marching orders that you had to implement in the medium, in the short term, medium, and the long term?
There were very serious concerns around the Auditor General's findings in the previous years, which had culminated in the SABC getting its well, for the longest of time, it had never got a clean audit. And the concern was that needed to be turned around rapidly. It was crucial. I mean, it was part of financial management and organizational management to be able to keep track of everything and have the supporting documents to show where business was going right and where it was going wrong. So that was the one strategic area. The second one had to be with the launch of the news channel, the SABC news channel. Quite a critical component from the perspective of being able to test our capability to run a 24-hour news channel so that when we migrated to DTT, then we would have a well-tested system that could run efficiently. So that was the second strategic area. The third one had to do with the skills within the organization. It was very, very clear right from the outset that particularly in the area of finance, there was a very big shortage of critical skills there. And when we put the proposal to the board that we ran a skills audit, it became like a natural thing to do. Why was a skills audit necessary? It was not geared towards getting rid of people. It was geared towards understanding what skills were in the organization, which potentially could be improved, who were sitting in the wrong positions, because the overall result you would then see in the general running of the business. So it was a critical aspect that had to be done. And there was a raft of human resource policies that had to be reviewed in order to ensure that the organizational behavior was realigned to running the organization in a manner that would help it meet its objectives. Of particular concern was our ability to operate effectively and efficiently when DTT came around. So that was a critical area as well. I've already mentioned finance as one of them. And I can't recall all of them, but I would say those were the top ones.
Now, you were meant to be at the SABC for 5 years, from 2012 to 2017. When did you leave?
I left on my last day was the 28th of February, 2014.
You roughly stayed just over 2 years?
Yes, it was, I would say, 2 years and possibly a few weeks.
At that stage, how far had you gone in terms of the marching orders you were given by the board in terms of implementing those?
The skills audit had been done and completed, and we presented it to the Portfolio Committee on Communications, as I can recall. It was highly publicized. It was done. The news channel was launched, albeit amid the controversy around the agreement with MultiChoice and a lot of unhappiness that was expressed around having a platform on MultiChoice instead of having it on SABC. There were serious concerns around that, but it was indeed launched. Financial management drastically improved. I will submit that on the audit findings perspective, we actually did a nosedive and ended up with a disclaimer in 2013. I'm not going to excuse the disclaimer. It had a lot to do with where having too many balls and trying to balance all of them and just losing focus on some of the critical areas. I think Mr. Lubisi has eloquently stated the work that the audit committee, together with the internal audit functionary and the executive, embarked on to make sure that all of these things were turned around. So that was achieved. The human resource policies became a contentious area because with some of the policies, it was felt that the labor unions needed to be involved. The processes were hugely protracted because everything had to be negotiated. So that did not go as well as I had hoped it would. I do believe that had I stayed on beyond the 2 years, that we possibly could have been able today to have had a very meaningful set of policies that could be implemented and followed by the staff.
Of course, for a group CEO to succeed, you need the support, the backing of your board. During your tenure, what was the relationship between yourself and your board?
The relationship, let me begin with the relationship between the board itself. It was highly fractious. And I think the Parliamentary Committee on Communications was exposed to huge fights that were happening between the board members themselves. And part of the problem was the camps that the board itself had created. In the main governance report that I believe has not been sent to the subcommittee, the ad hoc committee, it clearly points to the two centers of power that had developed at the SABC.
You served under the Dr. Ngubane board.
Yes.
You served under the interim board.
Yes.
And you had a stint with the current board.
Not the current board in its current form. I left before Ms. Shabalala resigned, before she resigned. So I for all intents and purposes, it was the Dr. Ngubane and the Ms. Shabalala boards that I served under.
Now, when you refer to huge fights between board members and the camps, to which one are you referring to?
I think if we take a moment and reflect back to the time when Dr. Ngubane's board dissolved, there were a great deal of fights within there. And the fights would sometimes spill over into the media, and they were hugely embarrassing. Within there were board members that seemed to surround Mr. Motsweni very tightly. And there were those who were seen as outside and therefore being the Lulama board. Very, very uncomfortable.
Sorry. Who were those that were seen to be around Mr. Motsweni, and who were those that were seen to be around Ms. Mokhobo?
It's not easy for me to mention names, but I think in my opening statements I mentioned that Dr. Ngubane was very close to Saudi. And there were about four other members of the board that were very close to him.
If you could share the names with the committee, Because you see, you're making the statement that there were two camps. And I think it's only fair for the committee to know who those who belonged to which camp.
Who supported who?
Yes.
I'm taking a very big risk here. I was aware that people like board member Lumko Mtinde, together with later Mr. Mavoso, Dr. Khumalo, Professor Khumalo, I can't recall all of them immediately, leaned very much towards my understanding. I came from a very strong academic background, and I think because of that, it was easy for us to understand each other in the strategic direction and operational direction that I felt needed to be done. But there were others. I don't think it would be fair for me to mention their names. I will be accused of slander. Who nonetheless were very close to Saudi.
And they would be the ones that you have not mentioned?
Yes.
You were still explaining these two different camps before I rudely interrupted you. I'm sorry for that.
I had very big difficulties. The report that, the governance report, for instance, pointed out that group executive meetings were not run well. And what I can state categorically now, and some of the executives who have left would confirm it, is that most of the time, the group executive meetings that are called, which were diarized and had to happen, would be undermined by Mr. Mutsweni. He would call his team. They would have other important things to do. And I would have to fight to have people stay and do their work within the committees. The extent to which I was undermined was unbearable. And as things would go, if the power of the leader is constantly eroded, and word goes around that this leader is useless, she is lazy, she's conflicted, she's got shares at ETV, her children work for ETV, she is all kinds, a litany of things that were said about me. The organization begins to view the leader as somebody who cannot be trusted, who is weak. And the one who seems strong, who is in fact driving these messages, then becomes the one who is seen as the leader. Those were the two camps. Those were the two centers of power.
But you were in charge. The COO, the CFO, until the cleaner at the SABC reported to you. You seem to have had a difficulty with one of your direct reports in the form of the acting COO. He was even acting at the time.
Yes, he was acting at the time.
What impeded you from dealing with him as your director within the confines of the law?
I raised the issue. In fact, I requested three board members who were in his camp to assist me with removing him. Because how things worked there, you had to lobby people sometimes to get them to understand where you were going and agree with you. And I raised the fact that there seemed to be a lack of understanding. Perhaps I was wrong, but a lack of understanding on his part as to what his role really was. And my suggestion to them was that he be found a different role. Now, I was in absolute shock when the following day, well, it was the same day, I can't quite recall, Mr. Mutsweni marched into my office absolutely furious, telling me that I shouldn't forget that if it were not for him, I would not be at the SABC. And that, in fact, those board members are so angry with me that I could possibly be fired. And thereafter, well, of course, I fought, you know, I fought back. And told him the context of my discussion with those people. And then thereafter, the strong rumors began to emerge. There were rumors that I would not be at the organization beyond August 2013. I had started in February. Suddenly, stories were being planted about me in the newspapers. I think the story of Mwabisa, Posani Mwabisa, who is indeed my nephew, and I'll never deny that, and his relationship and how my son worked with Posani. Everything that was put out in the media at that time was put out in order for me to seem like a totally dishonest, dishonorable person to the worst degree. It was a very painful period for me.
The three board members that you had approached, who can you give us their names that you were lobbying?
I would be hesitant to do that. Again, because I will be accused of slander. And secondly, I do not have the proof. There was no camera. I cannot show you a clip that says definitively these are the people who were there.
The delegation of authority framework, ma'am, sorry, because of time, I only have an hour, so I have to touch on different issues. The delegation of authority framework, how often was that document reviewed at your time at the SABC?
When I was at the SABC, we applied the old delegation of authority framework, which was very clear and consistent and delineated responsibilities very clearly. Towards my departure, a review was being done, and that review was essentially giving the executive far greater powers than they'd had previously. What Mr. Lubisi alluded to about executives essentially being given the right to appoint executives was one of the big areas that were changed. And also the levels of expenditure were changed. I wasn't there long enough to influence it differently. And in any case, at that time, relationships had broken down quite substantially.
This delegation of authority framework, my understanding is that it took certain powers of the board, delegated it to the executive directors. Now, who was responsible at your time for that particular arrangement?
The framework was, I'm trying to recall now because we're talking almost 3 years ago. The framework was reviewed by the group executive. I seem to recall that there were vigorous discussions on what needed to change and why. Part of the need had to do with how we could manage board involvement in the daily running of the SABC. It was a very frustrating thing because the executive found it difficult sometimes to make rapid decisions and respond very rapidly to market dynamics, such as needing to very quickly go and secure a programming deal or an event or whatever that would give it the competitive advantage. So those were kind of like the base things that had to be looked at. But I think what then happened was some of the powers that should have vested with the board were then devolved. But that was outside of my time period within that organization.
During your time, how did the board oversee their delegated power to the executive?
There were subcommittees of the board that were formed. I think Mr. Lubisi alluded to that. There were about six, if I'm not mistaken, perhaps slightly more, which worked directly with the group executives in receiving strategies and reports, whether it was updates or any other reports. And then the subcommittee chairs would then present those to the board for ratification, approval, or whatever was required, or information.
What were the powers of these subcommittees? Did these subcommittees make any binding decisions? And if so, were there any documents that had empowered them to make such binding decisions, or were they just making recommendations to the board?
They made recommendations to the board.
Would there be a regulatory framework or policy document that regulates that kind of an arrangement?
Yes. Yes, indeed.
What would it be?
That would be the delegation of authority document, which prescribed exactly what decisions needed to be taken where.
You resigned before the expiry of your time. Can you share the circumstances surrounding your resignation with the committee?
There were several periods when I disagreed with some of the decisions that were being made. And in those times, I would run head on with the chairperson, with Claudie, and with the chairperson. And our relationship deteriorated to the point where we actually had very, how do I put it, unbecoming arguments in the board. Now, things got to a point where the rumor mill started again. And there were talks of me being suspended. There were talks of investigations that were being done against me, like the ones that I mentioned right at the beginning. Being a shareholder at ETV, children working for ETV, me making bad decisions about certain people, et cetera, et cetera. And at that point, I decided that the writing was on the wall. I had been so maligned that staying on at the SABC just didn't make any sense to me anymore at all. But also, at that point, I believed I had done substantial work in helping, together with my small team of people who worked directly with me. We had made big headway in turning the financials of the organization around and other things that needed to happen, and that it was time to go.
I'll be interested. I mean, you were the CEO. How we judge you would be about the performance financially and the performance of the institution. At that stage, how were the finances of the SABC? How financially viable was the corporation?
I don't have the exact figure in my head, but certainly very viable. The SABC had made clear profits of over 300 million rand. And the previous year, it had been over 200 million rand. And there was over 1 billion rand cash in the bank. And at that point, we were ready to launch a new programming slate and had put out a call to the industry to submit proposals for a slate that would go to the tune of 600 million. So a lot was achieved, to the point that the government guarantee had been paid off. All our debts were settled. Whatever debts were outstanding had to do with, which had been long-term, had to do with litigation cases that had been ongoing.
What, I mean, one of your mandates related to austerity measures that you had to implement. And how far had you gone in terms of that?
We had, I'm saying we, but I don't like to say I, because I worked with a team of people. We had gone quite a way toward stabilizing the finances, dealing with the audit issues. Mr. Aguma had been appointed by Mutsweni, and he was very, very useful in helping us to establish a proper system of making sure that our audits were done properly, and therefore the report would not have really big qualification issues coming out. The content issues had stabilized. We had had a very big problem with media houses, the production houses that had to shut down because there was no money to pay them, and we're slowly bringing them back. There's so many things, I can't just recall all of them.
Your editorial policy designated you at the time as the chief editorial, whatever.
Editor-in-chief.
Editor-in-chief, yes. Mm-hmm. How was news independence maintained during your time?
I must contextualize this. News essentially had to play a role of providing news without fear or favor, while ensuring that the balance of views was captured within the news. So if there was a report going out, let us say, on you, Mr. Vanara, it was critical that you had the right of reply, and it was captured there. The head of news and his team had the right to select any news that they wanted to carry. However, if in the carriage of their responsibility there were complaints that were put to me about certain views that were being given undue coverage and others being suppressed, or if the head of news came to me and said, I'm having difficulty with this issue, can you help me with it? Then I would offer my opinion and I would assist where it was necessary to assist, whether it was by way of explaining to a party that felt badly done with to understand why we did the things that we did. However, if indeed in the carriage of his responsibility, the head of news seemed to be completely biased, unfair in their approach to news, I had the right to request him to give me whatever information that I needed, whether it was to understand why he was doing it, what the frequency was, and also to come up with remedial action.
The public protector's report, how was it handled whilst you were at the SABC?
When I left on the 28th of February 2014, it had just been released. So I was not there when any work was done around it. I had already left the SABC. However, I was aware that I was mentioned in there. And I would love to give context to my role that was mentioned in a very negative light in there.
I would like to give you that opportunity.
To give the context.
To deal with
indeed.
The issues.
The public protector was concerned about a salary increase. Initially, she thought that I had been involved in a whole range of salary increases for Musumusuni, but I had been involved in only one increase. And that increase was done at a time when the organization was going through a rebalancing of salary packages. I can't quite remember the word that was used internally to enable that process. Parity, it was called parity. And one of the instruments of checking parity was to look at what salaries were being paid at a particular level. And if indeed somebody's salary was below par and yet there was a general belief that they were delivering, then their salary had to be reviewed. And that's how Mr. Mutwening's salary was reviewed. He had complained that it was way too low. He had been given accolade after accolade by the board. So much had been said about the work that he did. Received a very glorious motivation from HR about him. And so the new salary was put down, and it was up to the chairman to approve it. The chairman agreed that indeed it had to be reviewed, and that was the salary that he was given.
If you say the chairman approved, my understanding
yes.
is the chairpersons of the board of the SABC are not executive chairpersons.
The assumption at the time was that the chairman of the board could on behalf of the board make certain decisions. Issues of parity were being handled along similar lines. So the chairman of the board, representing the board, therefore then signed for Mr. Mutwening to receive his salary increase.
Lastly, there was no performance management system at the time. Were there any performance bonuses that were paid to executives and members of staff, and if so, in terms of what regime?
Let me just correct you there, because when I left, a system had indeed been designed. And it was ready for implementation. And in fact, I a whole range of executives are evaluated against that performance management system. There had been a stoppage on bonuses simply because of the austerity period that we were going through. But also, performance bonuses had to be linked to actual performance. And year three was possibly going to be the year when we would link the assessments to an actual bonus. That would be at executive level. At lower management and staff level, there would be the 13th check, which generally people call a bonus. But it is, in fact, a 13th check, which would be awarded to staff at the end of the year. That was contained in the policies of the SABC, and it would be negotiated with the unions and taken to the board for approval. And if the board approved, then the staff would get it. During my period there, there was no performance bonus given to the executive team at all. None of the people who reported to me got that.
The very last issue relates to the multi-choice contract. I'm not going to ask you about its details. I'm interested in the role of the board. And my understanding is that you, as the group CEO at the time, you did not enter into negotiations, and you were not the one that signed the agreement. Can you explain how that came about?
There were two very contentious clauses, which can be summarized simply as the issue of the set-top box control. The broadcast digital migration policy, which is what had informed developments around DTT, had come with a provision for a set-top box control to be included in the new set-top boxes. And effectively what that would enable the public to do is that the public could access e-services. They could get into the internet and work on the internet right from home. It didn't matter how poor they were, but if they had a set-top box and it had a return path, then they'd be able to do that. Sadly, this argument was seen rather as a way to enrich a few manufacturers, which didn't make sense. And there was a strong drive to not include it, even the multi-choice agreement itself insisted on non-inclusion of that. That, I think, alone was the biggest reason why I had to go, where my relationship just deteriorated to the point of no return. During that week when the contract was signed, I'd gone on leave. My granddaughter was not well. And in my absence, it was quickly pushed through and signed. My stance against that particular aspect was very well known, and I still stand by it today.
No further questions, Chair.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you very much. Honorable Killian, your 5 minutes starts now. I had warned you that we're going to start on this side.
Chair, I would like to ask Ms. Mokhobo.
Mokhobo.
Okay. Mokhobo.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Can I just ask her, when she started, she was correct, she started during a very serious period for the SABC. When did you determine that there was a serious breakdown and the factions within the SABC board started? What prompted that feeling? Was there any particular incident?
There were a number of incidents. I think the Dr. Ngubane period did not affect me as badly as the Mrs. Shabalala period, in that term, the negativity around me was just untenable. Meetings were being held with executives without my presence. I would be shouted at and admonished in front of my junior staff for no reason. And generally, it just became totally, totally untenable. I must say that during Dr. Ngubane's time, when my frustrations were shooting high, he was the one who would calm me down, in all fairness. He's the one who would say, don't go, stay. But when the other chair came on board, it just was, it was incredibly difficult.
Can you tell us, during your term, there was a specific position created, stakeholder relations and provinces, etc. How did it come about that Mr. Motswaneng was appointed, and what was Dr. Ngubane's role in that? Was it ever approved by the board?
The board, prior to my going into the SABC, had done a very strong strategic direction, and reviewing the structures was part of their responsibility. So yes, they put that role in. The decision to appoint Mr. Motswaneng to that happened while I was not there yet, but it was entirely a board decision, I believe.
Che, can Ms. Mokhobo perhaps tell us when the public protector released the interim report? She was still at the SABC. When that showed up very clear problems surrounding the appointment of Mr. Motswaneng, what steps did you take, that you engaged, that you presented to the board? How did the board deal with the interim report?
I need to try and recall this. The interim report went to the chairman of the board. I'm sorry, I can't quite recall whether it was discussed at the board. However, specific questions were given, in particular to myself, which I responded to at length. My response is here, and I do believe that the public protector report is a public document now, so I would be happy to hand this in so that it can be seen. But being an interim report, then it was not, I don't think it was dealt with vigorously within the organization. It was more a matter of issues are raised, let's respond to the issues that are raised. And I responded to those that affected me directly. I believe Mr. Motswaneng dealt with his, and I don't know about the other board members. And I'm saying I don't know because the approach was very individual. It was, I'm mentioned here, I'd better respond. And the responses were sent back.
Unfortunately, your time is up, ma'am. Mr. Chauke?
No, thank you very much, Chair. During your time when you were harassed by Mr. Motswaneng, did the board or the chairman of the board intervene to try and resolve or to address this harassment? The second harassment, this newspaper reporting, which were false, Did you take any action either through the ombudsman, or did you ever complain to the newspapers that what they are reporting is not factual? The other question, obvious, it's around you keep on saying that part of the harassment was that your child worked for ETV. Is it correct or it's not? If so, how did it impact into your work? Those are my current two, three questions for now. And yeah, thanks.
Can I start with the ETV matter? It was completely false. And it just pushed me to the point where I realized how much people hated me, to the point of manufacturing stories like that. None of my children have ever worked for ETV. Yes, I was one of the people who were in the bid team that won the license for ETV, and we actually started, but then I left later, and I had no relationship with ETV beyond that. The reporting in the newspapers, when the some of the journalists came back with follow-up issues, I responded to those. I think probably at the time I naively believed that people would know me. You know, that's a naive thing, that even if people say bad things about me, but other people know who I am. And so I did not take the matters to the ombudsman. And there's a very recent case where the newspapers came up with this big article that said I had received 11 million rands in 8 months. And it was put down as a matter of fact. And it was totally untrue. And at that point, I think I was exhausted. I was just too beaten. I didn't defend myself. I didn't do anything about it. I just left it. The correct thing should have been for me to deal with it. My apologies. The first question had been
the issue of Mr. Ngubane as the chairperson of the board having to intervene on your harassment.
Yes. I tried several times to inform the board members, including the deputy chair of the board and Mr. Ngubane, Dr. Ngubane. But my complaints were seen more as crybaby. In fact, the statement was made that I did not want to take responsibility for anything. Therefore, I was a bad CEO. A CEO takes responsibility. Even if you have a staff member who does not do their work and that staff member has far greater power than you do because of who they know, well, if you can't deal with it, then it means you're not good.
The last question, Chair. Again, newspaper report that they alleges that you have paid 11 million. You're saying it's not in your way to respond on such issues. The public opinion is not everybody that knows you. Therefore, the public opinion majority then remains that you have been paid 11 million. Then it's fine, it's okay. You don't see any need that you need to take action because this is not the truth. Well, what makes you so comfortable not to want to engage on such matters?
I'm sorry, Honourable Chauke. I just didn't have the strength. I'm human. I'm just an ordinary human being. And I just didn't have the strength, and I knew that if I responded, then it would be a long, drawn-out matter. Then something else would come up, and another thing would come up, and yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Honorable Van Damme.
Thanks, Chairperson. Mrs. Mokhobo, you said that the multi-choice deal was pushed through when you were not at work. Do you know who gave, who signed that document, who signed that contract then?
Mr. Mutsuning.
Mr. Mutsuning, and with the board?
And with, I think, the chair of the board.
Okay.
If you got that contract, you'd be able to ascertain it.
We're waiting for it. Okay, I'm interested in your implication in the public protector's report. She says she recommended that remedial action be taken against you in the form of disciplinary action for approving Mr. Motsuneng's salary increase twice. The first time from 1.4 million to 1.7, and then 1.7 to 2.4 in the space of 1 year. In your responses to Mr. Vanara, you admit to the first increase, and you say
the second
increase. So both increases.
The first one was done before I was at the SABC, before I got there. So it's only one, the second one.
Yes. The public protector recommended that disciplinary steps against you be taken for approving that increase. What is your response to that?
I felt that the public protector had probably not understood the context, which is what I tried to provide here. That the increase was not, I think in her report, she said he was being paid as a COO. It was not in his position as an acting COO. It was purely in his position as group executive of stakeholder relations. And one who, I might add, had received all kinds of accolades, and I had no power to withhold that from him.
Right. The public protector yesterday, one of the remedial actions that she mentioned hadn't been implemented was those disciplinary steps against you. If you felt that that finding by the public protector was wrong and you do not agree with it, why didn't you take that matter on review? Why didn't you take that report on review? Because as we sit here, the SABC, there was a remedial action, a disciplinary action be taken against you, and it hasn't been taken, and you've left the matter, and you haven't challenged it. So what stops that disciplinary action being taken against you?
It never occurred to me that I should take it on review. I just thought reason would prevail. I mean, the facts were there. Yes, I think I displayed a lot of naivety on matters of public information. That is quite true. Should have done it, but I didn't.
Now that you have
Secondly, because I left also, I'm not sure what remedial action could be taken against somebody who was no longer there.
Okay. You received a settlement, and there isn't much clarity about how much that settlement was. How much was that settlement that you got from the SABC when you left 2 years into a 5-year term?
It was the equivalent of 1 year salary, which was with benefits, so with the car allowance and leave pay and all of those things, which came up to 4 million.
4 million.
And it was, I mean, that was almost a statutory requirement. You don't want a person in the organization, give them 1 year.
All right. Now, I mean, the impression that's created by all of this, you resign on the 2nd of February, the report comes out on the 14th of February, you would have seen the interim report which recommended that disciplinary action be taken against you. The impression that's created now is that you left because that report was coming out. Can you respond to that?
No. The discussion around my departure from the SABC began as early as November the previous year. I recall that when that final decision came through, there was a strategic session with the SABC board. And that strategic session is where the then chair of the board, Ms. Chabalala, informed the board that we had agreed to separate. So it really had nothing to do with the public protector report. As I recall, one of the things that she mentioned about taking the remedial action, she said, well, you know, how do you take a remedial action against somebody who has resigned? I'm not sure what my rights are. I will certainly investigate those, because I didn't listen to the discussions yesterday. I wasn't aware that that still stands as an issue. I will take advice and see how I can progress this matter.
Thank you very much, Honourable Waters.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Mokhobo. I hope I pronounced it right. Can you tell us, when you left the SABC, did you sign a confidentiality clause with them?
Indeed, sir. And that is the clause that I had discussions with Mr. Vanara about.
Mm.
And eventually I got a letter from the chairman basically stating that everything being done within the confines of this hall would remain safe from,
yes,
from
that's
prosecution.
Right. It's like
and
a court of law.
Yes.
Type of thing. Yeah. Okay. Can you tell us then, were you aware of any fraudulent, illegal, or irregular activities going on in the SABC?
The SIU report was probably the most telling of illegal, fraudulent activities that were going on within the organization. There was the case of the CFO. No, let me leave that. I don't think it's relevant to this discussion. But that SIU report was the most telling.
Okay. But that's in the public domain.
Yes.
So what were you concerned about? Why were you concerned about the confidentiality clause coming here if there was nothing to divulge?
Oops. What I'm divulging here today can, and it's been threatened, will be used against me. There was talk of people being sued, and yeah.
Okay. All right, thanks. Then with regards to Mr. Motseneng's two increases, I understand you were only involved in the second increase, but the chairman of the board at the time, was he or she one of the people that you've said that some of the board members surrounded Mr. Motseneng tightly, to quote you, and that the board had a leaning towards Mr. Motseneng. Would he be one of those or she be one of those people?
He was exceptionally close to the chair.
Okay, so we have a recommendation of two increases within a 4-month period, signed by someone that's very close to Mr. Motseneng. Did that not concern you at all?
You know, Honourable Waters, the reports that I got about Mr. Motseneng as I entered the organisation were those that spoke of an extraordinary human being who deserved all kinds of accolades. A lot of what he had done before I got into the SABC. And I could not question the veracity of those, because those are things that he was supposed to have done. And so when the request came to me, I did not have any leg to stand on from the perspective of saying no, particularly because it had to do with parity. It had to do with putting him on a salary level that was, suitable for a person, a group executive member of his standing. I must emphasize that, of his standing.
Okay.
It was extraordinary how much adoration was poured on him. And at the time of the parity exercise, I did not have the opportunity to really study him.
Mm. I mean, if board members are very close to him, there'd be a lot of admiration, and other people. So, you also mentioned earlier on that you refused to sign off on certain contracts when you first got into the position. Can you give us some indication of what contracts they were?
Was it? There was one that was particularly concerning, which had to do with the collection of VAT revenues from SARS. And the proposal was that that process be given to a third party. And I was actually quite annoyed when I received that because I could not understand. There is a Treasury Department at the SABC whose task is also to collect revenues from SARS. And I simply said no. And there was a lot of unhappiness about it, but I said no.
Okay. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. Honorable Oliver.
Thanks, Chair. Mrs. Mokhobo, when you tell your story, it's as if you were subjected to constructive dismissal. Why did you decide not to challenge it?
I think I mentioned earlier that I'm just a human being. I was exhausted. I got to a point where I felt there was nothing more that I could do. And I decided, you know, if the writing is on the wall, go, why force myself to stay on when I was not wanted? And things were being done about me and being put in the press to destroy me further. I couldn't allow my family to sit and read newspaper article after newspaper article where false claims were being made about me. And it was also to protect my family.
The current chairperson of the board, or the last board, Mr. Mokhobo, came in whilst you were still there. Did you provide him with Braille?
Yes, the Braille was bought while I was there.
Then one other thing I want to check. In your view, are there any shortcomings that you could pick up out of the memorandum of incorporation?
The new memorandum of incorporation, which I have not engaged properly, not with the thoroughness that perhaps because I'd left, I'd lost interest. But it seems to me that it sought to supersede what the Broadcasting Act was about. And I may be wrong, I'm no expert in these things, but I do believe that the Broadcasting Act is superior to the Companies Act. That the Broadcasting Act addresses very specifically the entity, and it's not just a generalized document. And therefore, I don't believe that it's proper to try and superimpose the Act above, sorry, the Companies Act above the Broadcasting Act.
I'll drop the last question, Chair, because it was digging deeper also on the MOI. So because she has already indicated that she never concentrated on it much, let me not go there. Thank you.
Honorable Khosa.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Ms. Mokhobo. Ms. Mokhobo, you've indicated that it was during the tenure of Ms. Tshabalala in particular that your operational performance was severely impacted upon, negatively impacted upon. Now, within the context of corporate governance and operational excellence, how would you characterize the two set of relationships? The relationship between Mr. Motsoneng and Dr. Ngubane, and the relationship between Ms. Tshabalala and Motsoneng. And again, if you could also indicate whether there was something about the two of them, because we've got to know it's public knowledge, but both of them did not have the necessary qualifications to occupy the positions that they were holding?
It's a difficult question that you're asking me, ma'am, because you're wanting me to give you a snapshot view of those relationships. I think they were completely wrong. If you appoint a CEO, surely the CEO has to be the head of the executive of the organization, and there can't be two heads. The function of the chief operations officer is to ensure that operations, and the operations being the radio stations and the television channels, are run effectively. And the reporting lines had to be COO to CEO. Yes, the three of us were executive directors on the board, and the three of us, therefore, would hold a level of joint responsibility in running the organization. However, from a board management of the executive perspective, I think the first line would have to be the CEO. And then let the CEO bring the COO in if it was necessary. I never had those problems with the CFO. And the three of us could be regarded as equivalents to a degree on the board. But I never had those problems with the CFO.
During your tenure, during 2013 during 2013-2014, the Auditor General reports an irregular expenditure of over close to 3.4 billion. What would you attribute this to?
Largely, the cause was the misreporting on SEP. There were very serious problems with systems not being applied appropriately. And in some instances, and perhaps the majority of the instances, it had to do with approvals not being awarded correctly. So an individual would have a project that they were doing, but they would not process it through the correct approval lines. And therefore, that expenditure could then therefore not be accounted for in terms of the normal prescripts of appropriate accounting. So those kinds of things would end up going into the fruitless and wasteful expenditure. On the SABC television side, there was a very peculiar problem with very long-term, in fact, they were called greenfields contracts, where a contract would just go on and on and on and on. And you would find that the programming actually was not being used simply because there was no space. Mandate requirements had gone up, and therefore international content sometimes was bought and was never used. That's fruitless and wasteful expenditure. And that would happen very much in instances where bulk buying was being done blindly without also taking into account whether there was space on the channel to put the content in or not. So those were kind of like the big issues.
Did you take part?
No, sorry, time is up, ma'am.
Okay, sure.
Honorable Mahlangu.
Chair, thank you. Madam, what I wanted to know from you is, during your tenure, who was the appointing authority?
For which level, sir?
For your senior levels.
The CEO, CFO, and COO would be appointed by the board with the ascension of the minister. And the level below that, who would be the group executive members, would be appointed by the board, and they would then notify the minister. The level below that, which would be general management, would be appointed by the group executive. Excuse me, the group executive.
I'm fine. Did you, as a group executive, make any irregular appointment during your tenure?
No.
So you're clean, you're fine. You knew that Mr. Mtswening did not have the required qualifications to attend?
Yes, I discovered that.
What action did you take?
Let me put it to you this way. When I was made aware that Mr. Mtswening had no qualification, it was within the context of, but wow, this guy really works. And that had come from a history of appointments and reappointments and him rising up the ladder as he went along. And the argument all the time was, he's extremely talented and you cannot use qualifications to exclude a person who is that talented and knowledgeable.
Chair, the other question I would like to, do you have any documentation that you know of that is commercially sensitive in the SABC if it were to be presented to Parliament?
The only commercially sensitive documents I can think of are the agreements between the SABC and the content suppliers, in particular the international suppliers, and also the SABC and the advertising fraternity. The advertising fraternity in particular would have problems because they negotiate rates with all the broadcasters. So if a slot on Generations for the SABC, I'm just going to use a hypothetical figure, is 100,000 rands per 30 seconds. And Generations is equivalent to, I can't think of a maybe to Rhythm City on ETV, and, you know, in the numbers, etc. And yet ETV is paid less. That potentially could be a problem. This is just a hypothetical thing. It's not that it's like that right now. But that is where the sensitivity would come in. But other than that, no.
Chair, I'm fine.
Honorable Gwen.
Thanks, Chair. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
I'm trying to understand the power dynamics at the SABC. You said there were two centers of power. I heard your side. Mr. Mtswening, and I don't want to speak about him because he's not the subject of this this platform here, but Mr. Mtswening, it seems, has gone through three or four tenures of board chairpersons who were in favor of him. Where was his real power coming from? Because it's clear that it wasn't coming from them. Who do you think was giving this immense power that you're speaking of to Mr. Mtswening?
May I decline to respond to that, please?
Okay, second question.
Thank you.
What was the relationship between the minister and Mrs. Tshabalala?
I don't know. Which minister? You mean...
The minister at the time of who was the minister
Mr.
at the
Karim.
Time? Sorry?
The Honorable Karim, Eunice
yes.
Karim.
What was the relationship between him and Mrs. Tshabalala?
Uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable.
Yes.
You were there when then there was a shift from Ms. Tshabalala to Mr. Maguve.
No, I had left.
You had left already, okay. Now, you also mentioned that Mr. Oguma was appointed by Mr. Mtswening.
Yes.
What were the circumstances of that appointment? Was it a fair process in your view? And how would you then describe this meteoric rise from where he was to acting GCEO?
Mr. Aguma is a highly qualified man. He had worked at the AG as well. So at the time of his being brought into the SABC, it made perfect sense. The disclaimer of opinion was there. Things were not going well in terms of our audit processes. And it had been agreed that the headhunting process could be applied there. And he was indeed headhunted and brought into the company.
Okay.
His meteoric rise, I cannot talk to because it happened after I'd left.
After your term, right. Okay. Okay, and then you did a skills audit, and we're now told that this is the last one that ever happened by the AG. What was your findings in terms of your skills canvas, so to speak?
I don't have the exact percentages.
Can I just rephrase it? This is one I should have warned you that is under contest. Maybe we should ask the question. Because if you come with the findings, this is the one that they're refusing to give us. If I'll allow you one more minute, is there any reason why that report should not be made available to us?
No.
Well, I'll allow you one more second, sir.
I do believe that the report was actually presented to the portfolio committee. So it's no longer a secret document.
Yeah, because that was my that was the reason I was, because I wanted to know what it is that in the skills audit that we're not supposed to know.
The skills audit does not point to any specific individuals by name. It gives percentages of skills and where problems were specifically and looks at where the misalignments in particular were between individuals, the job functions that they needed to do, and their ability to carry them, and whether or not that was linked to their skills. That's what it does. It paints a canvas.
So in your view, there's no reason why this document should not be?
Like I say, it was already presented to the then Portfolio Committee on Communications. And it was publicized in the newspapers, as I recall. There was a lot about it that was said.
Okay. And then also the AG spoke of irregular expenditure, and it's the board, it's the role of the board to then investigate irregular expenditure. And that task has not been done for the past 3 years or so. Can you tell us some of the issues that would have come up in your tenure as a CEO under irregular expenditure?
I think I explained that item a little earlier. Where it had to do with employees not using the correct processes to have approvals for projects to be taken. And sometimes those projects were actually not appropriate. And therefore, whatever was spent on them was a loss because they did not have any impact. But the more pervasive problem happened with content acquisitions, where certain content had been bought on evergreen contracts and yet could not be utilized. So payments were made, but there was just never enough space on any of the platforms to play out those. That was fruitless and wasteful expenditure.
Right. Last question. You spoke of threats, of people being sued, and so on and so forth. Where are those coming from?
I can't mention names, but I've been informed.
Can you give us just a general from the SABC?
Well, there's certain individuals within the SABC.
Who are threatening yourself.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Can I put mine? Then we can. Oh, no, it's fine. Put your point up.
Chair, we're trying to get an understanding of what's going on at the SABC. And the first question and the last question have not been answered. Now, the first question pertained to, from the Honourable Member of the EFF, where does Mr. Mosseneng get his power from? Where does he derive it from? And it's very important that we get an idea of how come one individual is so powerful within such a big organization and wields so much authority over other people. So I think, yeah, and then the last question as well is about who is threatening you. We need to know these. We need to know what's going on at the SABC. Thank you, Chair. And as Mrs. Mokhobo knows, she's protected here.
Chair, I think we have to be fair with our witnesses. We had made an undertaking that we are not going to put them in a compromised position. And if she feels, remember, we are not going to be with her when she steps out of this parliament. And I think we should let her answer what she is comfortable with. I honestly feel that we are pushing it too far, especially on the last question.
Thank you.
I need the wisdom of Solomon. No. No. Look, honourable members, I can, and I'm making the proposal because I think none of them are wrong. Can I have a private audience with this and any other witness as a first point of call? If you trust me as the chair, and let me make that call because indeed, members. If when we write our own report, this is a matter that will divide us, then we can put it in the report that one or two issues. I mean, we've now gone through five. I don't want us to mess it up for this one. So if you trust me, I'll have this one-on-one with her, evaluate whether I think it's going to substantially increase, because we haven't even gone through the process. At the end of the process, I'll evaluate those five or six that we are putting in embargo for now, collectively, and make that evaluation. I just don't want people to decide it's not worth our while coming back here tomorrow and that they come here under the whip, so to say. That's just my proposal, that if we did it that way. Mr. Mokhobo, only on that matter.
Yeah.
Mr. Mokhobo.
No, Chair, I'm comfortable with your solution, and I'm also very sensitive to protecting her especially. I asked those questions because I thought maybe she might be comfortable to answer, but if she's not, it's okay. But I think it would be correct that she, if she can do it in camera with you, it would be helpful. It would be extremely helpful. Thanks, ma'am.
Is there any violent opposition to that suggestion? No.
It's not violent.
Yeah. I'm being silly when I say violent.
There's a principal position that we took as a committee.
Talk in the mic, sir.
There's a principal position that we took in the committee that the protection of witnesses becomes paramount. In fact, when I extended that, we mandated you to deal with certain details with regard to security of witnesses. So I'll not want to go into that detail now, but I think I agree that privately you can engage on behalf of the committee. You can engage on such matters, and if there's a need to escalate, as we discuss as a committee, take it up from that level.
Can I just suggest something different? If it's a person who is no longer in the employ of a state institution, we can give them a little bit of room in terms of information they don't want to give us. But if it's someone who's employed by the SABC and we ask a question, they're under obligation to give us full information.
I'm not with you. Are you talking in connection with
yes.
this one?
Yes, yes. I'm saying, for example, if to give an example, if Prof. Maguve comes later on and we ask him a question, he can't then say, no, I don't feel comfortable answering that. If it's a person who's under the employ of a state institution, the SABC, they have to give us full disclosure. But if it's someone who isn't, and they, you know, then we can discuss it. We can give them a little bit of leeway.
You know, honourable members, I and I suppose we learn as we go along. I'm very reluctant for this committee to be seen to be divided on our procedures. And I'm not saying that we must be all the same. That's why I don't want to open it up for debate, ma'am. I mean, there's two suggestions that, and I think this one doesn't take away from the suggestion we made. Can we leave it, and because it's sprung upon us now, we'll refine it in our own little corner and take it. I don't want to open it up publicly. We are not divided. Thank you. One question from my side, ma'am. Did I, and it follows up on the point that was made by Honorable Mokhobo. Did I understand you correctly to say that the skills audit, and we're talking specifically about the one that was conducted by PricewaterhouseCoopers, was commissioned in your time?
Yes.
And also you now said at least two or three times to us that there is no reason why that thing should be, in the words of the legal advisor speaking on behalf of the board, the following documents will not be provided on the basis of privilege and its disclosure may negatively impact on the commercial interest. Are you saying to this committee that this document in no ways would have impacted on the interest or on the commercial interest of the SABC? I'm talking about the skills audit that was done by PricewaterhouseCoopers.
Oh, yes.
You confirm that it would?
I confirm that. I don't see how, really. I honestly don't see how.
Thank you very much. That then concludes the business for now. I beg your pardon.
We want to assure that there is no other person in the audience there, as we raised the matter earlier on, who would be disadvantaged as you close.
Yeah. Matlango has become my principal or a perfect, but it's fine. Is there anybody, not anybody, is the chairperson of the board, the CFO, the CEO, or the COO of the SABC present here? Because those are the only people that we will allow to answer. Abeko.
Sorry, Chair, I can't see them in here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ma'am Mokhobo, it is with gratitude that we want to say to you, we are still in meeting mode. Thank you very much, ma'am. If there were some uncomfortable moments, they were not intentional. But we want to get to the bottom of these things so that we are able to do a comprehensive and a thorough job. And we wish you well going forward. So thank you very much, ma'am, for your time. Much appreciated. You are free to go. Honorable members, it is 2 o'clock. Quarter to two. Back at 2. Unfortunately, this is what you guys said to me. The next one is at 2. We'll go to E209. 2 o'clock sharp, we are back here.